Chief Justice of India is about to arrive. I'd request everybody to kindly take your seats.
Tabla. Tabla, tabla.
Justice of India is arriving. Kindly maintain silence. We welcome the Honorable Chief Justice of India. Welcome, sir. We request Honorable Ms. Justice Seema Kohli, our chief patron, our founder patron, judge of the Honorable Supreme Court, to kindly come on the dais. Now I request Ms. Honorable Ms. Justice Mukta Gupta, ma'am, to kindly come on the dais. I request now Honorable Ms. Justice Rekha Palli, ma'am, to kindly come on the dais. I request Ms. Honorable Ms. Justice Pratibha Singh, Honorable Ms. Justice Pratibha M. Singh, to kindly come on the dais. I now request Ms. Maninder Acharya, the president of our organization, WIL, to also come on the dais. I request Ms. Rebecca John, senior advocate, the vice president of our organization, to please come on the dais. Kindly be seated. Maybe start. Good evening to all present. I'm extremely overwhelmed to get this opportunity to be a part of this proud occasion of felicitating Ms. Justice Seema Kohli, ma'am, on her elevation to the Supreme Court of India. Justice Kohli, the founder patron of our organization, WIL, the name which symbolizes the aura that the founder patron, that our founder patron exudes, WIL, that Cornelia Sorabji, the first Indian woman, displayed when she fought for even the right to study law in the 1890s, and her WIL to struggle for the right to be registered as a lawyer. WIL that has made all the women judges and lawyers present here get success despite various odds. On behalf of WIL, at the outset, I would like to convey our sincerest gratitude to our Honorable Chief Guest, the Honorable Mr. Justice N.V. Ramanna, sir, the Chief Justice of India, for gracing this occasion with his esteemed presence. Our revered Chief Justice, whose bold call for a 50% reservation for women at all levels of judiciary and reservation across all law colleges has jolted us, the women lawyers, out of our meek acceptance of the minuscule role that they have played so far. You, sir, have dared us to dream of an equal world. Thank you so much, sir. And now I request Ms. Maninder Acharya, senior advocate and former ASG, Delhi High Court, to come forward and felicitate the Honorable Chief Justice of India, Honorable Mr. Justice N.V. Ramanna, sir. I offer my regards to the lady judges present here today. I now request Ms. Rebecca John Memon, senior advocate, to come forward and felicitate the Honorable Ms. Justice. I'm so sorry, I think Ms. Justice Indira Banerjee is not here at the moment. I now request Ms. Rebecca John Memon to come forward and felicitate the Honorable Ms. Justice Hima Kohli, ma'am. I now request Ms. Tara Ganju to come forward and felicitate Honorable Justice Mukta Gupta, ma'am, the senior most judge from the High Court of Delhi, reckoned as an iron lady and an authority, especially in the domain of criminal laws. I request Ms. Binasha Soni to come forward and welcome Honorable Ms. Justice Anu Malhotra, ma'am. I request now Ms. Binasha Soni to come forward and welcome Honorable Ms. Justice Rekha Palli.
On the dice. Haan, niche rahe. Karein.
Now I request Ms. Ravi Birbal to come forward and felicitate Honorable Ms. Justice Anu Malhotra, ma'am. I request Ms. Ekta Sikri to come forward and felicitate Honorable Ms. Justice Pratibha M. Singh. I now request Ms. Sonia Mathur, Senior Advocate, to come forward and felicitate the Honorable Ms. Justice Jyoti Singh. I now request Ms. Madhumita Bhattacharji to come forward and felicitate Honorable Ms. Justice Asha Menon, ma'am. I offer my regards to Justice Sangeeta Dhingra, retired judge, Delhi High Court, who is present with us today. The three additional district judges, Ms. Aditi Chaudhary, Ms. Savitri Tyagi, and Ms. Surya Malik. Ms. Swarn Kanta, I stand corrected. I also welcome the Secretary, Learned Secretary General, Learned Registrar, and other officials from the Supreme Court of India, and all the women lawyers present here, both designated and non-designated, and to each one of the worthy, empowered participants present today. The evening is electrified by your presence. Talking of the first, we have with us the President of WIL, Ms. Maninder Acharya, the President of WIL, appointed as the first woman ASG of Delhi High Court or any other High Court. My memory goes back to 2018 when I went to meet her in her office. I saw the plaque and there was a long list of ASGs, all men, and a singular name prefixed by a miss stood out. It was a proud moment for me too. An all-rounder and a multifaceted senior who has experience of handling all kinds of commercial, corporate arbitration, insolvency, administrative law, and other kinds of litigation. Ms. Acharya was appointed as a senior counsel in 2013. She has been awarded the Star Litigator by the business world amongst her other awards. Ms. Acharya has shown to us that boundaries exist only in mind. And with that, I invite Ms. Acharya to give the welcome address and to share with us what WILL as an organization stands for.
Honorable the Chief Justice of India, Justice N.V. Ramanna, sir. Honorable Justice Hima Kohli, Judge Supreme Court. Honorable Justice Mukta Gupta, Justice Rekha Palli, Justice Pratibha M. Singh, Justice Asha Menon, Justice Jyoti Singh, Justice Anu Malhotra, Justice Dhingra, Justice Judges Delhi High Court, Senior Advocates, I see lot many of them here, Ms. Pinky Anand, a designated Senior Advocate, Ms. Avnish Elawat, much senior to all of us from whom we have learnt, Ms. Nitya Ramakrishnan, Gitanjali Anjana, all my other colleagues, advocates, interns in law and litigation. I welcome you all. This joyous evening, we have gathered here today for the felicitation of Honorable Justice Hima Kohli, our founder patron of WILL, who has been a judge in our High Court and has recently been elevated as the judge of the Supreme Court of India. It is our honor and privilege that Honorable the Chief Justice of India, Justice N.V. Ramanna, sir, is present amongst us as the chief guest to grace this occasion. Sir, we are always enthused and encouraged by your keen interest in the progress of women in law and litigation. A very warm welcome to you, sir. I welcome Honorable Justice Hima Kohli, who has been a judge in our High Court and is also the founder patron of WILL and has recently been elevated to the Supreme Court of India, prior to which she was the Chief Justice of Telangana High Court. A very inspiring journey, ma'am. Though we are very happy on your elevation, ma'am, but your humane and towering presence on the bench in Delhi High Court is sorely missed every day. A very warm welcome to you, ma'am. I welcome Honorable Justice Mukta Gupta, the senior most lady judge of our High Court. Honorable Justice Mukta Gupta remained standing counsel, Government of Delhi, a post akin to Advocate General in a state for long years. And all of us who were growing as lawyers in Delhi High Court have been inspired by her from time to time. A very warm welcome to ma'am. I welcome Honorable Justice Rekha Palli, Judge Delhi High Court and patron of WILL. In the meanwhile, I welcome Honorable Justice Indira Banerjee, who is now here with us.
Who has to do?
So now, since Honorable Justice Indira Banerjee is with us, I will request my learned friend, Ms. Kadambri, to welcome her with a gift of our regards and love. Kadambri. I welcome Honorable Justice Indira Banerjee, Judge Supreme Court, but who has moorings in our High Court also. Justice Banerjee was part of the High Court of Delhi from 8th August 2016 to 5th April 2017. Honorable Justice Banerjee has penned various judgments on NDPS Act besides other subjects which we use as precedents on daily basis. I welcome you, ma'am. Now I welcome Honorable Justice Rekha Palli, Judge Delhi High Court and patron of Will, I won't be wrong to say that Justice Rekha Palli's name has become synonymous with the cause of short service commissioned officers whose cause she fought in a very feisty and enthusiastic manner as a lawyer and succeeded as a senior advocate before being elevated to the bench. I welcome you, ma'am. Now I welcome Honorable Justice Pratibha M. Singh, founder patron of Will and Judge Delhi High Court. I will not be wrong if I call her a superstar achiever in the field of law relating to intellectual property rights. She achieved many a seemingly impossible feats, including establishing her own specialized law firm. She opened doors for the next generation of lawyers practicing in the said niche area of intellectual property law. She made it possible for others to dream. I extend my warm welcome to you, ma'am. I now welcome Honorable Justice Jyoti Singh, who practiced as a lawyer, then as a senior advocate in Delhi High Court for long, long years, painstakingly building her practice from scratch with devotion and dedication. A known name in service law, especially law relating to armed forces, paramilitary forces, Justice Jyoti Singh was elevated to the bench in 2018. I welcome you, ma'am. I welcome Honorable Justice Asha Menon. Justice Asha Menon, besides being known for her very humane and sensitive judgments, is also known for having represented India at the Asia-Pacific Regional Consultation on HIV-related legal services and rights in 2012 at Bangkok. She has also been a part of Indian delegation that visited Malawi, Africa under the aegis of United Nations Development Programme. I welcome you, ma'am. I welcome Honorable Justice Anu Malhotra, who has been a judge since 26 July 85, besides penning various notable judgments, has also been a director of Delhi Judicial Academy for 2 years and a fellow of Commonwealth Judicial Institute, Canada. Almost every other day, ma'am, we use the judgments penned by you on original side and various other subjects. I welcome you, ma'am. Coming back to Will, Women in Law and Litigation, which is a society registered under Societies Registration Act, was conceived and founded by our founder patron, Honorable Justice Hima Kohli, with a firm grip on law and her court, and awe-inspiring command over her language and diction. She was at the relevant time judge of Delhi High Court. Justice Pratibha M. Singh, who is also our founder patron, was at the relevant time a practicing lawyer in intellectual property rights, opening doors for many and inspiring many, and few of us who were senior advocates and advocates. Later on, Honorable Justice Rekha Palli accepted our request and became a part of the Will. All these members on bench and bar brought their special experiences in profession and personal experiences due to their personal journeys and enriched Will and continue to enrich Will. A woman's journey in law and related fields in any role, be it as a lawyer, a senior advocate, a judge, a solicitor, a partner in a law firm, junior in litigating chamber, or an intern, it is very distinct and different from that of her male counterparts. More so, because in a field dominated by men, women in every role in law and litigation have had to go through a tough struggle to claim their ground. Undoubtedly, today, women are scaling newer peaks every day, but it will not be wrong to say that they are still struggling. Will was formed with an objective to provide a shared platform where women in law and litigation, irrespective of the role they are playing and seniority they enjoy, could come together and share their knowledge to take help from each other, inspire each other, and be inspired in return. A common turf where seniors could share their knowledge and expertise and mentor the juniors, and in return, gain from their energy, fresh ideas, proficiency in technology, and knowledge of budding fields in law. Keeping in view this objective, we have been holding seminars, webinars, knowledge workshops, and lectures, etc., which have received a very enthusiastic attendance. During COVID, our seminars, including the one on the art of cross-examination in criminal law, addressed by our member, senior advocate Ms. Rebecca M. John, and an interactive session between Honorable Justice Hima Kohli, Justice Pratibha M. Singh, and myself on the topic of virtual hearings and techniques involved were very well attended. Today, as I stand here, witnessing a row full of women judges of Supreme Court and Delhi High Court, a large gathering of advocates and senior advocates, I am overwhelmed. It has taken us a long time and a grueling struggle against all odds to reach here. In the last two decades, especially women in law and litigation have covered various milestones. The honorable judges sitting here were elevated during this period. Women advocates were designated as senior advocates, and few women were appointed as law officers. We have one of them, Ms. Pinky Anand, sitting there while I was at the High Court. Many a glass ceilings have been broken. Many are showing visible cracks, and still many remain to be shattered. All this women have done and achieved while balancing a life in which childbearing and child-rearing age coincides with the age when you are grappling with professional struggles and trying to climb up the ladder in profession. In legal profession, where, because of its very nature and complexities, maternity leave and benefits are not possible, women have been able to achieve success due to their sheer grit, determination, better time management skills, multitasking, single-minded devotion, and support and encouragement from their families. I would be failing in my duty if I failed to mention two more important factors which have contributed to the growth of women in this field, and that is the unabiding, unshakable faith of their clients in them and recognition of their merit, competence, and hard work by the honorable judges, that is judiciary. We are thankful for that. However, a lot remains to be achieved. We need to see a dawn when a woman judge, woman senior advocate, and a woman law officer shall not remain a novelty. Something extraordinary or news to carry home. When a sea of women professionals in every role in law and litigation will stand merged and mixed with their male counterparts, obliterating the need of prefix woman before various positions. To my younger friends, I would say there is nothing that a heady cocktail of grit, long hours, and determination cannot achieve. Future in law and litigation for you all is very promising. For each one of you, you have to keep walking steadily and surely on the path to success. A large strength of you present here assures me that many more milestones will be achieved in future. We will wait for that happening future. As Sheryl Sandberg, the first woman CEO of Facebook, in her book Lean In says, and which I often repeat, boundaries exist only in our minds. And those are the only boundaries that we need to transcend. I take this opportunity to announce that our mentorship program, in which women lawyers from various fields are available for guidance, which had slowed down during the COVID, is going to be kick-started in January. List of mentors and other necessary details will be displayed on our website, which can be accessed by those who wish to register. I will end with the quote of great seer Rumi: as you start to walk on the way, the path appears. So just walk, just keep walking. With this, my heartfelt thanks to Honorable Chief Justice N.V. Ramanna, who has really encouraged us by taking out his valuable time to be present here and be part of this felicitation proceedings. And honorable judges, all the honorable judges, my friends, lawyers, senior advocates, interns, and everyone from any role of law and litigation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Acharya, for sharing what WILL stands for, its activities, and the future roadmap. I'm sure with your kind of leadership and the leadership we have both from the bench and the bar, the organization will come as a very strong organization, creating a pressure group for all the women lawyers to participate in and to look as a platform to grow. Before I go further, I also wanted to extend a warm welcome to Ms. Pinky Anand, the former the senior advocate and former ASG for Union of India from Supreme Court, who's also here. We have here as our next esteemed speaker, our founder member, and now a patron, Justice Pratibha M. Singh. The name itself suggesting brilliance. Justice Pratibha Singh has left a trailblazer of a professional journey, one of the best known IPR lawyers, effortlessly transitioning into her role as an erudite judge, with many significant contributions to the academic, literature, and legal developments in the intellectual property law as a practicing lawyer, and as an advisor to several legislative assemblies, including drafting of the first national IPR policy in 2015. With many international awards in the field of IPR for her and her firm, in 2013, Justice Singh was designated as a senior advocate by the High Court of Delhi. In May 2017, Justice Pratibha Singh was elevated as the judge of the High Court of Delhi, and thereafter with many notable judgments to her credit, which due to paucity of time, I'm unable to elucidate. However, for the young lawyers, one very worthwhile thing that I wanted to mention is that Justice Pratibha Singh has donated a scholarship that allows other Indian students to complete an LLM at the world-renowned Faculty of Law in the University of Cambridge. Thank you, ma'am, for the boost given to the young lawyers. I now request Honorable Ms. Justice Pratibha Singh to come on the stage, on the dais, and to say, address the gathering. A very good evening, Honorable Chief Justice of India, Justice N.V. Ramana. I don't think you've had a hall full of women, and you being the only man ever before. So I think this is very deserving for the simple reason that you are the first Chief Justice of India who spoke about women becoming 50% in the law and judiciary. So, it's wonderful to have you here, sir, in our forum today. And of course, what a happy occasion we are here in to felicitate Justice Hima Kohli. You know, we've all seen Justice Hima Kohli with her petite personality and beautiful saris and heels strutting around in the High Court as a lawyer, then to become a judge and our patron in WILL. And now to achieve the first ever feat for the Delhi High Court, the first woman judge from the Delhi High Court in the Supreme Court of India. Am I right, ma'am? You're the first woman judge? Yes. Justice Indira Banerjee, thank you, ma'am, for being here with us. And it's we are the host today because it's WILL, which is what we all conceived so many years ago. My senior colleague, Justice Gupta, my colleagues on the dais, off the dais, district judges, all the ex-judges of our High Court, senior advocates, Maninder, Rebecca, Geeta, Pinky. I can see so many, I can't name all of you. It's so wonderful to be here today and just see all of you and meet all of you, though with masks, then we can't show off our beautiful faces. Okay, let me start by, I just want to speak in two segments. The first segment I would like to address is, what are the challenges that women face in this profession? When I see all of you, I almost think I'm ancient, because I joined the Delhi High Court in 1992 when I returned from Cambridge, and I was not a North Indian. I was a Bangalorean girl who just decided to practice in Delhi High Court. But I must say, I don't think I could have been here in this position if I was not in the Delhi High Court. It's the most cosmopolitan court in the country. Nobody asks you where you come from. Nobody asks you which caste you belong to. Nobody asks you which religion you belong to. Nobody asks you whom are you married to. So everyone judges you by your capability, by your competence. If you're competent, judges give you the order. If you're not, sorry, bad luck. So having said that, it hasn't been a life without challenges. The first ever woman in the Delhi High Court who was designated as a senior advocate was just 3 or 4 years before all of us got designated, Mrs. Chandramani Chopra, I think, if I'm not wrong. And Mrs. Shamla Pappu. And then came the new lot. I think Jyoti made it first. Then Rekha, Maninder, myself, we were all in 1 or 2 years gap, we all got designated. But one thing, Rebecca, of course. But one thing I must say, each of us, the women who got designated, were the topmost in our fields. And you will believe when I'm saying this, this is a challenge, because women had to be twice as better to make it as senior counsels. Right? But I remember even in the small stint when Justice Ramana was the Chief Justice, I was designated at that time in 2013. And it's been a beautiful journey. Women have really made it well in the Delhi High Court. And I'm sure the path has actually been laid. And it's going to be a brilliant path where, I mean, I don't think it's not about glass ceilings anymore. There is no ceiling. That's what I would believe. And I think the Delhi High Court is very lucky that we've been able to create an atmosphere, thanks, I would say, to all the men in the Delhi High Court, both the judges and the lawyers, who've been kind enough to recognize the women, to encourage us, and to not believe that women only are deserving to take Passovers and adjournments, which used to be the case 25 years ago. So what are the challenges? There are a couple of points only that I wish to make on this. And that is, the first and the foremost thing is, women, especially with families, there are challenges that we faced all through. How do we manage children? How do we become mothers? How do we become wives? How do we become daughters-in-law? It is possible. And the only way it is possible is to sacrifice your own time and take all the stress with a smile. If you keep smiling, the path will be laid out for you. And secondly, I want to say that it's very nice to make your children independent, though initially they do believe, oh, chachi to ghar pe hoti hai, maasi bhi ghar pe hoti hai, mummy nahi hoti. But you know, after when they are 7, 8 or 10, they then start feeling proud. Oh, my mom is a lawyer. And she argues cases every day. My mom is a senior advocate. And then there is a time when they really, really feel very proud of you. And they feel inspired by you. So don't feel that the struggle is not worth it. It's really worth it. And you'll realize it very, very soon. Thirdly, I want to say that for women, it's always difficult to tread the path of being aggressive in court. If you're aggressive, if you shout, यू मे बी ब्रांडेड एज कंटेंकरस. भाई कितनी जोर से बोलती है, बहुत लड़ाकी. और इफ यू आर सॉफ्ट, नहीं सुनाई देगा. सो आई बिलीव दैट द प्रोफेशन हैज मैच्योर्ड एंड एज अ जज आई कैन से दैट वी डोंट नीड टू शाउट. इट्स द आर्ट ऑफ पर्सुएजन दैट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर लॉयर्स. दिस इज नॉट अ शाउटिंग गेम. And so, if you can't shout, don't worry about it. And I think post the pandemic, it has become easy for lawyers, especially women. I've heard of at least 3 or 4 stories during the last 2 years when women have told me that they've been able to recommence their litigation practice because they are able to make their own study space at home. They're able to work from home. They're able to appear and also take care of their children and their homes. So the pandemic has in fact been a boon. And going forward, obviously, I'm sure hybrid courts are going to be here for some time. So women should take advantage of this. So just few more points before I end my address. What should women do? That's the question that young women always ask me. The first thing is, don't seek sympathy and pity from the court, from the other side, from the lawyers on the other side, or from your clerk as well. You don't have to tell them or tell the court, my child is unwell, I have to pick up my daughter from school. Please don't do that, because that stereotypes you. You should know how to manage your time and manage it in a competent manner. Secondly, always be ahead of the curve. Read, be competent, give up your Bollywood movies, give up your shopping, give up your parlor time, and dedicate it to law. And then you'll see, within 10 years, you'll be there. It is tough, it is a lot of hard work, but with competence and hard work, you can make it. Pick your battles. Don't fight with everybody. You fight only if it's needed. Keep your steely resolve with a smile. Young girls ask me, is it good to specialize? I think it's wonderful for women to specialize. Because when you specialize in a particular field of law, it requires lesser time to understand that field. So it's good to specialize and also make it in that particular field. So that, see, law is very common, it's commonsensical. If you handle one area of law, you can handle another area of law. It is not difficult. But specialization is helpful and it will help you achieve quicker. Not to say that you shouldn't do general practice. Always keep domestic help, keep a driver. Don't start feeling I have to sacrifice. Sacrificial mentality is not required for women. You just have to fight it, keep a grip on everything. Always engage your driver, because you can then work in the car as well. When you go to senior counsels, take your children with you. Get them to do their homework in the car. And while the senior counsel makes you wait, please finish up with the homework. The senior counsel is happy that you've brought your child. And this is what I did all my life. No frivolity in the profession. You can have your friends with whom you can enjoy the evening. It's very difficult, especially in commercial litigation, to make it, because one doesn't know how to network. Most general counsels are men. Now there's a change. So can you go out for a beer with a man? Very difficult. But then you have to be more competent to make sure that they have very limited choice, that they then have to come to you. Force them to come to you and they will come to you. And clients also realize that if you have the commitment, you can then make it. So I just want to end my address by saying, hard work, perseverance will get you where you have to. And we are several women on the bench. There are going to be more, hopefully. And as we go forward, nobody will come and wonder what happened to Justice Leela Seth in 1978. There was an anecdote, and I would like to end with this. Justice Leela Seth was sitting in the Delhi High Court one day when a group of people flooded her courtroom. She asked her clerk whether there was a newsworthy case in her court, which is what attracted everybody. She was informed that the audience was a group of farmers who had come to Delhi upon invitation from the Prime Minister to see the capital sights. They had just been to the zoo and their next stop was the High Court. To see what? To see a woman judge. So, 1978, today we are in 2021. I don't think we belong to the zoo anymore. And we are all happy and keep smiling. Enjoy your evening. Thank you so much. I thank Justice Pratibha M. Singh for her energetic address with several counsels for all of us. The time is short, and I will go to our next speaker, Justice Rekha Palli, our worthy patron and also sitting judge of Delhi High Court. Justice Palli was appointed as the judge to the High Court of Delhi in 2017. She has been a judge in a number of politically significant cases, has shown her mettle and courage in handling sensitive cases. One recent case that I wanted to mention, where Justice Rekha Palli observed that child has the right to use her mother's surname. Father does not own the daughter. Madam, we invite you to share with us your experience while transitioning from a successful woman lawyer to being elevated as the judge of this court.
Justice Ramanna, Justice Indira Banerjee, Justice Hima Kohli, and all my friends at the bar and at the bench. I'm actually privileged to be given this opportunity to be a part of an event to felicitate a person, someone whom I have personally admired and have a lot of affection for. In fact, if you would say, my journey at the bench actually started almost sitting with Justice Hima Kohli, and I think that was my biggest privilege, something I will really cherish. I mean, knowing Justice Hima Kohli, and so even though I am supposed to talk on my transition from bar to the bench, I cannot stop myself from first beginning to thank Justice Hima Kohli for have been such a good mentor. When I joined the bench, when I sat with her, I will say with due apology, ma'am, I was a little scared because from outside your image was a little. But the moment I sat with you, I realized you were one of the finest judges to sit with and start. Every matter you would tell me, encourage me to ask questions, and probably that was something which has shaped me into what I am today. Today I don't shy away from speaking my mind. As a lot of you would know, maybe it's not called for or not, but that's what I learned. And the way she would handle everything with dignity. I mean, her sense of authority in court was with so much dignity. She did not need to really raise her voice. Those are very, very important things. So I was really happy when I was told that this is a function to felicitate her. Now when I talk about the thing, today when I see this hall full of so many excellent women lawyers, it's very hard to imagine that about less than 100 years ago, we women were not even being allowed to be enrolled as lawyers. As I think Kadambri spoke about it in the beginning and Ms. Acharya, that 100 years ago, Legal Practitioners Act needed to be, there was an amendment finally which came, which permitted women to start practicing. It was that journey, and look at it today, the room is full of such high achievers. I mean, some of them, when they appear in my court, I have to actually give them double attention because I know they will be much, much better prepared than a lot of other lawyers. Now coming to my journey from transitioning from bar to the bench. As I've always said, as lawyers, for a woman, it is always tougher. There is no doubt. Justice Pratibha Singh has talked a lot about it. There is no doubt for a woman. You need to exercise caution in court. You don't need to raise your voice. That's correct. But shifting from bar to the bench, that is, in fact, believe me, it is tougher. As in the bar, when you are there, male lawyers, with all apologies, they don't have a problem. You are arguing your matter, they are arguing theirs. You're not taking their matters really, because that's the way it was. But when you are at the bench, you, and especially when you sit single, you have to handle a lot of male lawyers with a lot of dignity. They have to get the message that you are not there just as a showpiece. You are not there as a you are there because you have worked your way up. You have worked your way up. In fact, coming to the bench is something a lot of people would think, especially in the High Court, and the Supreme Court, that you women have a lot of responsibilities towards the family. They may not be able to devote their 100%. And this is a judge's profession actually requires a lot of resilience, strength and authority, which they are still not willing to associate with a lady because they think they are nurturers. They have to devote time to the family. If there will be a wedding in the family, they will go on leave. They will do this. That's not true anymore. We are women here to prove that we are there and to pave the way for many more younger girls who are sitting here. So I will not take so much time, but I will only say that yes, the journey from the bar to the bench has been in the beginning tough, made it much easier because of Justice Hima Kohli, because that's where I picked up lot of things. How to finish your work in the day to go and not leave the court without completing all the orders. That is one thing which I have stuck on to. I will only say it's a journey, it's a very, very challenging trajectory, but no doubt it's a very rewarding one when you feel the satisfaction on the client's face that you have delivered, you have done something which needed courage. It's a very satisfying feeling. You can sleep with a lot of satisfaction. So I would only say the young lawyers here, I'm so happy to see so many of you and I wish you all the best. Keep up the good work and this will is going to help you because this is a place where you can discuss your problems, where you can see how other women have come up, how other women have managed their time. I mean, I'm a mother of two children who've been brought up in fact, I became an advocate in record when my son was 6 months old. It's not, so if I could do it, I'm sure all of you can do it. All the best, and I think I will not take time because we are already behind schedule. Have a good evening.
Thank you, Justice Palli, for sharing your experiences and how the canvas, and for sharing with us how the canvas has changed, yet the hurdles remain. Even when you transition to the bench, some hurdles still remain. We have as our next esteemed speaker, Her Ladyship Justice Indira Banerjee, tall as she stands in her stature as a judge of the Supreme Court, and as an individual, calm with an incredible capability of tracing any speck of lack of equity from the volumes of documents that she reads from the files. Lawyers who have the chance to interact with her gush about her warmth and dignified grace that she exudes. Elevated as a judge to the Kolkata High Court in 2002, and then a brief stint as the judge of the Delhi High Court in 2016 and Madras High Court in 2017, Justice Indira Banerjee became the 8th woman judge of the Supreme Court of India. As the famous saying goes, with power comes responsibility, which leads us to ask you, madam, the question, is judging a difficult task? Are decisions somewhat differently put when placed with a feminine perspective? Please share your views with us.
The Honorable, the Chief Justice of India, Justice Hima Kohli, Justice Mukta Gupta, Justice Rekha Palli, Justice Pratibha Singh, Ms.
Rebecca, I know her first name, what's his name? And
Ms. Acharya, my colleagues from Delhi High Court right in front of me, and all the wonderful ladies of the profession in front of me. It's a real pleasure to see so many ladies assembled here today. I still remember when I had joined the profession in 1985, there were just a handful of lawyers, and we would be the center of attention wherever we went, whether it was in the courtroom, whether it was in the bar room, or whether it was elsewhere. But before going on, this is an occasion to felicitate Justice Hima Kohli. I congratulate Hima Kohli once again, because I've done it many times before. But I take this opportunity to thank the Chief Justice and his colleagues on the Collegium, who have for the first time thought of elevating three women to the bench of the Supreme Court at the same time. And possibly for the first time in the history of the Supreme Court, the percentage of women has exceeded 10%. I am particularly thankful that he didn't leave me to be the only one. I know what it feels like, because I was the only one lady on the bench of the Calcutta High Court from 5th February 2002 till 22nd June 2006. Wow. 4 years, almost 4.5 years. So it's a real pleasure, and I do hope the Chief Justice will think of some more on the bench. Of the Supreme Court, I will be retiring in September 2022. The number should not go down, Chief. So I request you to think of elevating one or two more before I get into office. Now, coming to what I've been asked to speak on, it's the voice of the judge. It made me think a little. After almost 20 years of judging, I really started pondering on the voice of the judge. You know, when we were in the bar, we were always told, and we always believed that is the traditional view, that judges speak through their judgments. Anything else that the judge says is not of much importance or not of much significance, because what we say through our judgments is respected, it has to be obeyed. Whether people like it or not, they have to implement what is directed by the judges. In that sense, our judgments and our orders are our voice. But even before I dictated my first order, I was called upon to speak as a judge. And this was when I had to respond to the felicitation. I remember I was brief. I thanked the members of the bar profusely, and I assured them that I would do my level best to live up to the oath of office which I had taken. I assured them that I would deliver justice without fear, favor, impartially, to the best of my ability. Yet, we do have to speak sometimes, even in court. I remember
just a few years back, someone, a totally non-legal person, telling me something in the context of a comment which was reported in the newspapers, alleged to have been made by one of the judges. I was told it takes a few years to learn to speak, but it takes a lifetime to learn what not to speak. Therefore, when you talk about the voice of the judge, it is very important to know what to say. It is equally important to know what not to say and to sometimes keep quiet. There is a difference between a lawyer and a judge. A lawyer is being watched when she is arguing in a court of law. She is being watched by her client when she is arguing the case of the client. And the client is judging the lawyer by the result. In the case of the judge, a judge is being watched all the time. And the voice of the judge, no matter how soft, it rings loud. To give a small example, just last year, I was on the bench with a colleague who has been elevated to the Supreme Court from the Calcutta High Court, who happens to speak the same language as I do. And I very quietly told him in Bengali, why vacation bench? Meaning, what is the urgency? There was no urgency in a petition which was being moved in the vacation bench. On the next day, I had a news report in Anand Bazar Patrika of Calcutta forwarded to me. And it mentioned our schooling, the school we went to, the college we went to, where we had come from, and what I had said, and how my brother had responded. So this is the glare on the judges. Therefore, though we are judging from maybe 10:30 to 4 o'clock, and afterwards when we write our judgments, but we are being watched all the time. When the orders go in favor of the litigant, that litigant is very happy. I still remember when I had delivered a judgment way back in 2007. It was a very interesting case because it involved the BCCI and Jagmohan Dalmia. Jagmohan Dalmia won, and he made a statement in the press that it shows that the judiciary is still vibrant. Yes, if the order is in your favor, the judiciary is indeed vibrant. And in Madras High Court, when I had to decide a highly contentious political case on the next day, thank God, I knew a little bit of Tamil, maybe a few sentences here and there, but I didn't know Tamil well enough to watch a television program and understand what was being said, or I was not able to read. But I was told I was slammed. And on the next day, the matter was mentioned in my court, or else I would not even have known. A lawyer came, mentioned the matter in my court, and asked me to issue a rule of contempt. I thought it was not worth giving so much importance to the criticism made by a disgruntled, unsuccessful litigant. So I just told the lawyer,
Today is the last day. We have a heavy board. Let us continue with the case. He told me, but it's a question of the majesty and the dignity of this court. They have not just criticized the judgment, but they have made personal allegations. They have attributed motives. I replied, our judgment is reasoned. It's up on the website. The people of Tamil Nadu are educated. Most of them are erudite. It is for them to judge. And so far as the dignity and majesty of the court is concerned, you lawyers are there to protect the dignity and majesty of the court. Just as I was criticized for the judgment which I had written, 2 days later, a wonderful editorial came out in the Deccan Chronicle referring to this incident. The editorial was titled, Dignity of the Court Lies in Its Restraint. And probably what was said in the article was much more than what I really deserved. So, you know, we have ups, we have our downs, we have to be objective. Now, so far as the voice of the judge is concerned, when we deliver our judgments by being proactive, by purposefully interpreting welfare statutes, beneficial statutes, we can make a lot of difference. Many of my judges have done. Many of my colleagues have done that. But I can assure you one thing. When it comes to judging, there is not much difference whether you're a woman on the bench or whether you're a man on the bench. Because we have just seen Justice Ramanna, how he has encouraged women. Probably women get a much better deal from him than they do from me. because I tend to be more strict. Apart from actually writing our orders, dictating our orders, we sometimes do have to speak in court. Now, some judges are labeled as the quiet judges. Others are labeled as extremely talkative judges. I remember as a lawyer, I used to find very talkative judges a little difficult to tackle because instead of listening, you know, they would go on and on and on arguing the case. And then you can't put down the judge in the same way that you put down an opponent. So I tried to be a little less talkative on the bench and I try to listen a little more. Apart from speaking through our judgments, there has been a little change today. Like, I get called upon to speak here and express my views, share my views with you. It's no part of judging. Similarly, by reason of enactment of various laws, let us say the Legal Services Authorities Act, the judges play a greater role. Their role is not restricted to their conventional role of simply judging matters. Today, judges even take part in camps for sensitization,
creating legal awareness. And I found that right from the beginning, as a judge, I had to participate in a lot of these camps, possibly because for 4 years I was the only woman, and they wanted to showcase a woman in every camp. And I'll tell you about my hilarious experience in one such camp, which was organized by the All India Women's Conference, the Calcutta chapter of the All India Women's Conference. I started to speak, and I thought I was speaking quite well. Just then, a group of people, a group of ladies sitting in the first row said, "Banglai bolin, banglai bolin." That is, please speak in Bengali, please speak in Bengali. And oh my God, not used to giving public speeches. First of all, not used to giving public speeches. Maybe used to arguing in courts. And then not used to giving public speeches in Bengali. The embarrassment, you know, with the TV cameras all focused on me. I think it still gives me goose pimples even today. Fortunately, I have a brother judge, a man, obviously. I kept on turning to him and saying, "Constitution, what is the Bengali for constitution?" Sangvidhan, Sangvidhan. So this is how I had to deliver my speech. But then things improved with the passage of time. Now, the voice of the judge, what we speak, one, it can have an impact on society, it can change ideas, because people do look up to a judge. We may say that anything else that a judge says apart from what is said in a judgment or order is really not of much consequence, because no one is bound to obey it. They may just ignore it. But the fact remains that because people look up to judges, you can make a difference. You can sensitize people. Change. Bring about a change in the traditional mindset of people, which are not really conducive to women's equality. There is a third aspect, voice of judges. That is what the judges have to say about themselves. That aspect I've covered to some extent, but I think I've already much exceeded 5 minutes. Amongst lawyers, I remember those good old days in the profession when you could talk as long as you wanted to. And old habits, after all, die hard. Please excuse me, Chief Justice. I seek your pardon. As it is, I delayed for health reasons, and now I further delay you. Thank you very much for putting up with me.
Thank you, Justice Banerjee, for propelling the Honorable Chief Justice of India from making even more efforts to ensure a gender equality. I'm wondering whether I should ask for 70% and not 50%. And also, thank you for telling us the importance of silence. I think most of us could learn from it. We now move to our next session, and we are extremely eager to hear the lady who has been the force behind making of this organization. Our founder patron, Honorable Ms. Justice Seema Kohli, who, while she climbed the ladder, did not obliterate her struggle and challenges as a woman lawyer and a judge, but rather using her experiences, propelled the formation of this organization, WIL, Women in Law and Litigation. Justice Kohli started her practice in 1984 as the legal advisor to various government and private organizations, standing counsel to NDMC, additional standing counsel to the government of NCT of Delhi till 2006, when she was elevated to the High Court of Delhi as a judge. During her tenure as a High Court judge, should I? Yeah. Yes. I was, in fact, hoping that since we are felicitating Justice Kohli, we would really have a lot of words to talk about her judgments and the person that she is. But because we have to take care of the time, we would simply just request Justice Kohli to elucidate her views with us. And one particular statement which she made recently, that it is the, on her elevation and the three other judges, that it is not a benchmark, but a starting point. We are very eager, Justice Kohli, to hear you on what lays ahead of us. Thank you.
Very good evening to all of you. I first apologize to Kadambri for cutting her short. It felt like she is carrying coal to Newcastle. Most of us know you, and I know all of you. I think maybe a handful of youngsters, I know all of you by perhaps by name. So really, it's a true homecoming in every which way. I'm so thankful for WIL to have organized this function. I start by greeting Honorable the Chief Justice, Justice Ramanna, and take the liberty of being informal with the rest of you, including Indira Di, my colleagues from the Delhi High Court, both on the dais and off the dais, Maninder, Rebecca, senior advocates, esteemed guests, friends from the media, district judges, young interns, lawyers of every hue, with only one common factor, the gender. It's really a delight to be here with you on this special occasion. WIL has always been very close to my heart. And just to share with you, it started from round table that some of us were sharing at a dinner that was hosted by Mamta Mehra at her residence. And just as we were sitting and chatting, and we thought that there were so many things that we would love to share of each other, with each other, and maybe inspire other women in litigation to come and join the profession. And that is how WIL was born. And I'm so glad that we could actually formulate a trust, WIL as a society, and carry it further by doing things which we thought would be a good cause for women practitioners. And that is why the name Women in Law and Litigation. It is a different matter that acronym also stands for WIL, that you will and we will collectively carry forward the onerous task, and sometimes a very heavy one, of attracting more women to this profession, making them more comfortable, mentoring them, helping them, extending all kind of assistance to them, just as we thought we hadn't received, or we thought we had received, both ways. I'm fortunate that I had an excellent mentor, as the former Chief Justice of India, Justice Y.K. Sabharwal, Justice Vijayendra Jain. And I'm glad that I had friends who reached out and helped me in my trying times. And I'm sure all of us have at some occasion or the other felt a vacuum which a colleague, and many times a woman colleague, has been able to fill up. So that sense of of belonging to the bar, that sense of belonging to the bench, is extremely imperative to give that comfort to a woman in a profession like this one. There is no old boys club that keeps the women bonded. And there is no networking that mostly works for women. They're standalone. Very few of them have been able to establish themselves with the speed which perhaps Delhi High Court has offered to women both on the bench and the bar when compared to many states. It is heartening to know that so many of you are here, and I'm particularly happy to see the young faces who are here, because we want to carry our tales to them and to share our experiences with you too, so that you're all inspired to get many more on board and make the strength go stronger of women at every level. Rekha was mentioning that I used to encourage her when I, and she sat with me, and it was an all-woman bench, which was also something very unusual in our court. But I must say that it was the same encouragement I received from Dr. M.K. Sharma when I sat with him. I haven't forgotten on the first day when my family was there for the oath and I sat with him. And I'd read all night long, not realizing what will be admission and what will be after notice and should I read the regulars too? That typical thing of, and he kept, I would put a question to him and say, "Sir, I think this point," and twice and thrice I did that, thank you. The fourth time he said, "Hima, your whole family is sitting at the back and watching you. Why don't you ask a question yourself?" And again, it's a full circle. I've had the privilege of sitting with Honorable the CJI for the last few months. And I think I keep badgering him with some questions and say, "What about this and what about that?" And finally he says, "Hima, why don't you ask yourself?" But that is with some trepidation that one does that. One is sitting in a haloed court of the Chief Justice of the country. And as Indira Dee said, you don't want to transgress, and sometimes it is better to be silent and hear than speak. And that is what we all as judges have learned, having metamorphosized from a lawyer to a judge. As a lawyer, I was told that when you face the judge, you're only looking at one person, and I'll share it with you. You must do that and remember. And imagine in your mind that all those who are sitting behind you, the lawyers, are nothing but blocks of wood. You just focus on what you have to argue to the court and forget about the rest. And that stayed with me. So don't be embarrassed. We all make mistakes, not just as lawyers, as judges, and that is why there are appellate courts. But there's somebody to correct us, and we learn from, as long as we learn from each lesson that we carry with us. And be better the next time. Always come prepared to court. Don't let the judge get the impression you weren't prepared. Be candid enough to say if you didn't have the brief because your senior didn't give it. Perhaps for various reasons, including the lack of confidence of a client in a junior colleague, which also happens. Keep the aggression in court. Don't carry it home. And for judges, I think it's important to keep the mantle outside the gate of your house when you walk in. These are a few things that I think my colleagues on the dais and off the dais will also agree with, that it's a tough and a very lonely journey. It's the existence of a goldfish in a glass bowl for a judge, because you're being watched. And if you're a judge in court, you're always a judge outside the court also. You have to make sure that the aura and the dignity that goes with this post is maintained. And however frivolous you may feel like being, it's always within your four walls of your house and not outside. Because there are others watching you carefully, and you symbolize the whole system. So it's best that you maintain that when you're outside in a public space. Anything private should remain private. That is also equally important, I think, for something I can share with all of you. I don't think I'd like to take more time, except that I had this wonderful quote I came across, and I thought that it would inspire all of us. So I'd only share that with you. I am winning the rest of my speech. I don't intend to bother you with it. So what I'll read out to you is what Oliver Napoleon, the famous American civil rights attorney, who successfully undermined the segregation and discrimination in all walks of life, had said, and I quote, "Do not wait. The time will never be just right. Start where you stand and work whatever tools you may have at your command. And better tools will be found as you go along." I strongly endorse this statement. Time will never be right for a woman to make a mark in the legal profession. It is now. Here, live in the present. Start with the smallest case that you get. Give it your best shot. Work with whatever facilities you may have. If you don't have an office, doesn't matter. I started from a dicky of my car. It doesn't matter. You could have just a locker in your coat to just keep your gown and your case diary. It doesn't matter. It should be that will that you have inside of you and that fervor of being the best that takes you forward. Do not look for better opportunities. They will come as you chart your course in the legal profession. Another beautiful quote which applies to all of us here is that each time a woman stands for herself without claiming it and without knowing it, she stands for all women. I would say that those of us who have made even that little dint in our profession stand for all the rest of us who are going to make that difference very soon. So, shatter more glass ceilings, break more barriers, cross more boundaries, keep reinventing yourself. And that is the mantra, I think, that we need to carry forward. We are fortunate that we have a Chief Justice who is so proactive when it comes to representation of women on the bench. We are blessed that we are four of us today in the Supreme Court, and as Indira Adi said, we hope there are more. The Chief Justice is doing well.
Thank you, ma'am, for your inspiring address. Clearly, the message from Justice Kohli is that not only the Caesar, but also Caesar's wife must also be above board. And with that, we hope we will be able to follow the footsteps of Justice Kohli fearlessly, with the understanding that there are no limitations. And now I'm a bit torn between giving a long introduction to our Honorable Chief Guest, the Honorable Chief Justice of India. But allow me, sir, to say a few lines about you. and then I will just cut it short. And Honorable Mr. Justice N.V. Ramanna, sir, is our 48th Chief Justice of our country, who as a person deeply understands, perhaps more than the women themselves, their potential and the abysmal state of underrepresentation. He's a chief who has walked the talk, and we really look forward to the further efforts that he will make on our behalf, and we hope to follow his slogan, "All the women of the world unite." It's a Karl Marx slogan, modified. We have nothing to lose but our chains. Sir, with that, I request you to kindly address the gathering.
Thank you. Sister Indira Banerjee, Judge Supreme Court of India. Sister Justice Hima Kohli, Founder Patron of Women in Law Litigation Will. Justice Mukta Gupta, Justice Rekha Pali, Justice Pratibha M. Singh, all our patrons and founder members of Will, and sitting and former judges of Delhi High Court, Judicial Officer, Ms. Maninda Acharya, Senior Advocate and the President of Will, Ms. Rebecca M. John, Senior Advocate and Vice President Will, Ms. Kadambari, Advocate and Secretary General Will, members of the governing body of Will, Senior Advocates, Advocates, other distinguished guests, media persons, law clerks and law interns, law students. Good evening. At the outset, I must say my sincere thanks to the Will who has given me the opportunity of interacting with you in this evening. I never forget your affection, support, encouragement was shown on the last occasion when we felicitated the four judges of the Supreme Court in the India International Center. Now, Madam Kadambari said that I have modified the version of Karl Marx about that nothing to lose except chains. Thereafter, I want to tell something. Some organization has sent a communication to the concerned people in the highest saying that the Chief Justice is provoking revolution. So, now after coming here, I am getting some messages from my, some of them are my brothers and some of them are sisters also, asking me, are you comfortable with the so many women? It's a vibrating moment. I'm very much comfortable and I'm very happy. In fact, I want to share one thing. I think all my life incidents which are I think I share only when women advocates meets only. It's obvious. Because I am a 21 years, I think as a second year BSc graduate, I used to be the secretary of Tobacco Women Organization, which is 20,000 members. And I used to manage these 20,000 women workers and their problems, and I used to address them. And I used to meet every day at least 100 or 200 people and to take their grievances. So I am very much comfortable and very happy and to be with you, all of you. It's quite relaxing and energetic because the Justice Hima is saying, Chief, are you comfortable and are you okay? A lot of stress you are this. Yes, I am in really stress. A lot of issues are there. As a Chief Justice, you can't avoid. Again, I have to attend another important meeting, but I am happy at least in this premises that hearing you and your claps from the beginning to now on the same sound and wavelength it is going on. That itself shows. That itself shows that you are very much concerned. Normally, meetings, first 1 minute, 2 minutes, first one or two speakers, claps will be very loud and thereafter it will go down. But from the beginning, you are doing good clapping. See, I don't want to talk much because whatever I have to say already I have told last time. And in fact, there is a breach of promise. Hima and Madam Manindar and Ms. Rebecca, when they came, I said that I won't speak much. I will hear all of you, and so I will at least know what is the issues. Sister Indira Banerjee, Pratibha Singh, Hima, and Rebecca as well as Manindra Acharya. All of you have brought to the, all of you have explained the problems, and majority of the problems are issues. I don't say problems are issues. You have enlightened, and you have particularly, it is very much useful to the young girls sitting in the back row, which they have to lead the life. But however, one good thing which I am observing is that last week when I attended the convocation of this National Law University Delhi, and all the, I think at least 50% of the strength is girls. And all the gold medals, except one or two gentlemen, all of them got to the gold. I'm very happy to note that this is a very good symptom and a signal for the future of the women lawyers or women legal professionals in the country. And only one disappointing thing is, I asked the girls who got the gold medals on the dais itself, after congratulating, what are you going to do? Are you going to join in the profession? Or out of four, almost except one, three of them said that I want to join in a law firm, I want to go to civils, I want to go to some teaching and all that. Only one girl said that I want to be in litigation. I want that ratio has to be improved, because they have to come to the profession. The purpose of the particularly National Law School's education is to encourage the lawyers to come into the mainstream and give a quality legal aid or to the strengthen the legal system in this country. I wish that majority of the women has to come to this profession. The other issues is, which I have already told you last time, that we are having only 30% of women judges, particularly in the subordinate courts, and 10% or 11% in high courts and Supreme Court. Now, while coming to the dais, Rekha, Ms. Rekha Pally, saying that when Kadambari demanded 70%, she says that yes, backlog also. I will definitely place this demand before the members of the Collegium, and I will tell my brother judges and the chief judges of different high courts. In fact, we are in trying to impress upon the chief judges also to at least each time when they are recommending at least one or two names, compulsorily they have to include in the list. So far as Delhi is concerned, I think it's quite good number, and we are expecting some more people also to join shortly. This is one good thing. My advice is not much. The issues which I have already last time pointed out, this in profession, the various barriers which women are facing, is that the continued prevalence of certain attitudes about the role of women in society. This issue is a problem a woman faces regardless of the type of employment. Another issue is the bias that women face, whether from their colleagues or litigants. This bias affects not just women advocates, but also those on the bench. Third is, this creates a complete unwelcoming atmosphere within the courtrooms for women. It is the duty of the lawyers and judges to ensure that a friendly environment is created in courtrooms. The fourth one is about the judicial infrastructure, which I am advocating very strongly, is to strengthen the women's participation. Why? Because is that the small crowded courtrooms, narrow corridors, and some of the courts doesn't have in facilities of the restrooms or child care facilities, etc. And only around 22 to 25% of the courtrooms in the country doesn't have even washroom facilities. This is the picture of this Indian courts. That is the reason why I am advocating this infrastructure particularly has to be provided by the government. So at least you can go to the court and comfortably sit there for some time. It is a fact that all these issues are not possible to solve in one day, but I am trying my best, and every forum, wherever I get an opportunity, highlighting these issues and bringing it to the notice of this government. I hope that they will realize and they will support and they will take care of these issues. These are the main issues which I thought of. Sister Banerjee, while talking, said about the certain issues which was faced by the judges. It applies not only judges, to lawyers also. Sometimes if you speak one sentence, they may take out of context. I will narrate one small incident. When Justice Hima and myself and another judge, while sitting very recently in hearing a very sensitive case, she made an observation. "You are dragging your feet." This is the only observation she made. Next day, all the newspapers, TV channels, that is the banner. She is a little scared and asked, "Chief, did I committed a mistake?" Anything? Nothing wrong. It is, you are entitled to express your view. There is nothing wrong. See, English can be twisted any way which you like. It is the media or some channels, they will try to pick up the sentences here and there they may give, which is attractive and juicy. This is part of life. And in public life, we have to, either judges or lawyers, we are all in public life. You are no more sitting at home and doing your other things. So once if you come on street, you are bound to get brickbats, bouquets, comments. It is all part. So you need not worry about that, and you have to ignore and you have to go ahead. This is what I advise. So I don't take it very seriously. This is all part of life. We have to continue our journey. And I request one more thing also, when Madam Banerjee is talking about the talking of the public speeches. It's not a great thing. I told all of you, and it is nothing. I have never had an occasion to talk in a public meetings and addressing, except the trade union movement or farmers' issues, student issues. But one good thing is I am a voracious reader, and I learned Telugu language, that is my mother tongue. And I read all the books, important books, in whether it is relevant or irrelevant, literature, poetry, history, and all that. So that made me a strong basis for me to talk, even though I started my English at 8th class and degree intermediate in law only. I converted my medium of instruction in English. That is the basis. So I advise you all mothers, please teach your children mother tongue. If you teach mother tongue, your student, the child is very confident. He communicate properly. And the thought process, we have to understand, if somebody asks some question, your brain thinks in the language which your mother tongue. And thereafter, you translate it into the other language. So the translation part is something different. So thought process is important. Thought process will be in mother tongue only. So the fundamentals of the mother tongue and language has very important. We have to encourage children to talk whatever mother tongue you are, whichever language, it is important. This is what I feel, and I advocate strongly this. And more than this, I don't want to say anything. It's already too late. Tomorrow is a hectic day for all of you, and me also, and other judges also. And and I must congratulate the Will organization, and with a great vision, and they have started this organization. They are doing a lot of service and giving inspiration and taking care of the problems of the particularly women advocates in Delhi. I just want to say a few words about Justice Hima. Sister, you are the inspiration to all the young girls and women of this country. And you have got this position not because of somebody's mercy or some reservation or somebody's favoritism. You got all because of your hard work and your commitment. So I am happy that the bill has taken up today this program, and I congratulate and I thank Will for doing this occasion, and that's all. I don't want to add anything further, and if a chance comes once again we'll meet, and it should be a full day of taking some issues and discussing across the table. So instead of this talking and all that, we can invite some more judges of the Supreme Court also, so they can also participate and they will also understand your agony, problems and all that. I wish you all the best. Thank you. Give me the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Your address, brimming with positivity, sensitivity, humility, and humor, has been a great experience for all of us. And now I request Ms. Rebecca John, Memon John, the senior advocate, to come and say the vote of thanks. Thank you.
Honorable the Chief Justice, Honorable Ms. Justice Indira Banerjee, Honorable Ms. Justice Hima Kohli, Justice Mukta Gupta, Justice Pratibha Singh, Justice Rekha Palli, judges off the dais, other honorable judges, senior advocates, my colleagues and friends. On behalf of Will, I wish to thank all honorable judges, colleagues and friends for joining us today for the felicitation of our founder patron, Justice Hima Kohli, on her elevation to the Supreme Court of India. I especially thank Honorable the Chief Justice for taking time out from his busy schedule and gracing this occasion. Will was created as a platform for women to celebrate their experiences and share their grievances and struggles. Over the past few weeks, I have been asked by many male colleagues as to why women insist on creating what appear to be separate spaces. My answer to them was that litigation itself was for decades largely a domain where women were excluded. This platform seeks to change that history and make law and litigation a more inclusive space. Will seeks to empower women in law and litigation, and these and the inspirational stories we have heard today form a part of that endeavor. I thank you all for being part of this celebration. I now request all of you to join us for dinner. Honorable Chief Justice, we have a special Saltindian platter. I hope you can join us as well. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you.